starts at 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock is the final phase, so 6 o'clock prayer, and we just do, I thought we could have that prayer. Okay. Anytime in that 6 o'clock hour, you can come, and then we start at 7 o'clock. Tomorrow. Sometimes people are like, I forgot, we used to do it on Wednesdays, we have moved it to Mondays. And then Virgil and Wanda Long, they'll be here with us the next 3 weeks, starting next week. And just love them. Talk about people who live in such a room, like to get such a grace. I don't know, I guess you call it old school Pentecostal. We just adore them, they're going to be here. We will be here next week, but then we will be absent for 2 weeks. And then October 6th, we would like to do a church dinner after service and a month celebrating the Feast of Trumpets. So we just like to recognize the seasons we're in and then just get up more and get in the seasons in the Bible. Because that, we said to do that always. So we just want to recognize the time of season and help all fit together. So we will do that on October 6th, and we will be providing parts to take and all that good stuff. So if any ladies just want to bring in sweet. With that, I'm going to open us up and pray. Oh, and I do want to welcome all of our guests here. So thanks for coming out. We hope you can feel comfortable and joining us and worshiping the Lord today. And with that, Lord, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for everything you've done for us, Lord. Thank you for the provision over our families. Thank you for the love and the concern that you have for us, even when we were lost, Lord God. Lord, we pray those that are in our families, maybe our children or our lost loved ones, Lord, we know that you've been long-suffering, and we just thank you for that, and we thank you that you love them even when they don't know you. We call in the lost loved ones. We call in those whose hearts have been hardened right now. Lord, may your Holy Spirit go and soften the hearts of those around us. Lord, prepare us with giving a good word, your gospel word, your good word over those people. Lord, may we lift you up this week in a way and in a manner, Lord, that puts us there before you, Lord God. Open hearts before you, Lord. As you do a mighty work in this body of believers, we just honor you and we thank you in this place for what you're about to do. We thank you that you're weaving your people together. Lord, as the remnant stays strong and tied together in this day and this hour, we rejoice in that. And we give you all the glory and all the honor. Worship today? Yeah. Yes, we do have a lot of fun. I'm
Thank you. Thank you.
being brave anymore? Oh my goodness, I am. I'm so glad I'm not buried under my shame anymore. I'm so glad that I'm able to walk free as a child of the light, being led by the one shepherd who knows the way. Amen. I'm Hallelujah.
Oh, my God. praise Him for provision. Let's praise Him for healing. Let's praise Him because some things have come against you, but He said the time is now. I've heard your prayers. I've heard your decrees. And I'm about to answer on your behalf. Those things you're believing for are coming to fruition. Don't give up. Don't give up. Don't quit now. You're almost there. Just a little bit farther. Press in deeper than you've ever pressed before, says the Lord. Lord God, we thank you today that, Lord, the victory is in our hands. We thank you today, Lord God, that, Lord, the battle is yours. And we thank you today that you are moving on our behalf, that, Lord God, that you're making ways where there were no ways. Lord, you're creating opportunity. You're making doors open that no man can open, that only you can open. And you're closing doors that no man can close, that only you can close. And today in this place, Lord God, we want to say thank you for it. Come on, just thank Him right now. Thank you. That part of faith is you got to thank Him for it. You may not see it with your eyes, but you got to believe it in your heart, and it will be so. Lord, we say it is so today by the power of agreement. Lord, we agree with your word for what you're doing. We receive those things which we have needed in the name of Jesus. Everybody said, amen. I want to shake hands with a couple other people while you're here. We'll switch over. Glad you all made it out today. It's a beautiful day. It's a good day to praise the Lord. I know that you guys, but how many feel like you've been in a kind of a tough season for a little while? Is it just me? There's a few of us. It seems like you're just down and you're like, where is the weakness coming in? I have done these things. And sometimes there's seasons for us to go through, the seasons in life. But I believe we're in a spiritual season. So, as I get to the fall feast, and I don't want to talk about today, I'm hoping you guys are okay if I just kind of talk a little bit today. Not a whole lot of verses, which is not typical of me. But I want to tell you this is what's on my heart. Doug's in our hospital this week. That's a praise report. Praise you for it. Come on, Doug. Hallelujah. Thank you. It is. It is the power of prayer and in the name of Jesus. And we got to remember that. We can't give up. Because it says, don't get weary of doing good if you'll reap a harvest if you do not give up. And we're so close. It's like, but it's getting hard in the world, amen? And it's getting tough out there. There's not a lot of good news anymore. You know, these were articles about good things that happen in the community, whatever. Those are good far for you between these days. It's just a bad thing to happen. It's trying to take a toll on the people of God. But I have good news today, because I truly believe that the season is about to shift. I'm not saying that just to prophesy, I'm not saying that to do good things, and you can be like, oh, cool, I'll do that. It's good to see that. But I'm saying that because we're about to shift seasons. I want to talk to you today about a little bit about the Jewish feast. Now, do you guys know anything about Jewish feast? A little bit, we talked about it here. Well, we're coming to the feast of Trumpets. Now, that is Rosh Hashanah, and that is the new year, the head of the year. That's the beginning of that, the Jewish New Year. And coming to God's calendar is not our calendar. He doesn't go by Greco-Roman calendar, he goes by the Jewish calendar. He does things according to Israel, according to America. We think because we're in America, we kind of judge everything we see by what we think and hear with our Western mindset, if you will. But everything comes back down to the biblical and kind of understanding what it meant to the people at that time. And so we kind of start to understand that we start to understand the times we're in, the season we're in, that it's not over until Jesus says it's over. And we're about to see a victory. And then, can I show you that in the Word? Rosh Hashanah, just to give you a background on Rosh Hashanah, according to the Torah, which is the first five books of the Bible there, the story of creation, Genesis says, it was evening and was morning, day one. So, we say day starts at midnight, but the next day starts at 6 p.m. according to the Jewish calendar, because it was not then day. So they do things opposite. So we, like I said, it really messes with your head. It's hard to, like, get it down. Even if you understand that, it's so hard to do it. It's kind of, is that tomorrow? Or is that today? So it's hard to get that down. But it's October 2nd is Rosh Hashanah. And Rosh Hashanah is what they call a high holy day. It's a time, fall, peace time. It's a time where you're required to go. It's a time where you hear that there's a, it's called a piece of trumpet. And the reason why is that what would happen is they would have to send a watchman, several watchmen, they would look for a moon. But not a full moon, it's a crescent moon. And so they looked for the sliver of the moon, and they would, as soon as they saw it, they would blow the trumpets and call everyone to assemble. Well, the problem was, is that you couldn't tell the day or the hour on the piece of compass because there was no set time when they were going to see it. They had to visibly see and connect to the moon and blow the trumpet. That's why it's called the piece of compass. And so, when they saw it, it could be a day off. It could be a couple. Until they saw the actual moon, that's when the feast started. And that's why it says no man knows the day or the hour the Son of Man comes. I'm going to unpack this a little bit. I'm going to slow it down just a hair because I need a little more background. But, moving with Rosh Hashanah, it's according to Jewish tradition, but they're very good on their traditions. They're very good with their religion. But the world was created in Rosh Hashanah. In the same month, Adam and Eve, because they were created during that week, in the middle of Jewish tradition, that is Rosh Hashanah. Was the beginning of the world and the beginning of all things and all the things here on earth. Whether that's true or not, we can debate that for a little while. But I thought we'd just kind of listen to that. And the new moon is just a dark, it's just a really thin crack. You can barely see the moon, you're just kind of waiting for that to happen. But I lost the time. I did a study this last year, so I look it up on the internet, though, on YouTube, on our website, which is myheart.life. By the way, for those of you who don't have our app, we have an app. It's myheart.life. It's called the MyHeart app, the Google Store, and the app. And so I've recommend downloading it for you. But it gives you the, you know, we'll look at these things that go on, like, tomorrow, we'll give you one more about the way of these things. So, Rosh Hashanah, important about the Rosh Hashanah is that the books were opened. Did you know that there's books in heaven? Did you know there's all kinds of books in heaven? There's the Book of the Living, which is called the Book of Destiny. There's the Book of Tears. I'm not trying to give a brief, but I'm not studying on that, so just give you a brief background. Like I said, I did a lot of teaching on this last year, so you see me put a little point here. There's a little bit on my heart today. But there's the Book of Tears. It says, you said your tears come before God as an offering, as an offering. But He knows the tears that you cry. He knows. This is important to know, because we tend to think of God as far off and untouchable and uncaring and unconcerned with your daily life. But God said, no, I am with you even to the end of the age. He said, I am here with you right beside you. He sees your tears and He cherishes your tears. He knows what you're going through and He's making ways and so you to know what He's doing in that background. And that's why that song before is just, you got to trust Him. And yeah, the timing may not be your timing, and I wish it was my timing. Because if it was my timing, we'd be wrapped up in the faith, we'd be all in heaven. Amen. Because this didn't know me out there. But it's not my timing, it's God's timing. I really have to trust Him and who He is. But here's the Book of Tears that we can have to tear your pride. You also have the Book of Remembrance. He remembers those things about you. It's things about you that's personal to you. A book of what you do. He said, I know your work. I know what you do. So sometimes you think that He doesn't see the things that you do, and nobody does, and nobody says thank you, nobody cares if you do those things. Sometimes it seems like you just take it for granted, and no one even understands what you go through to do what you do, and they don't even care, but God says, I do, I have a book of work. I have a book of work, empty, and it comes up as a memorial before me. For years, that book was opened with chapter 10 of Cornelius. And so that's when he was the first Gentile to see the baptism of the Holy Spirit. He says, your works have come up before me. Your arms have come up before me, says God. And so I want to bless you for that. He knows everything about you. He's concerned with everything that concerns you. He's not so far off that he can't hear you. He doesn't know what you're going through. The book of life, most important book, is the man written in the Lamb's book of life. Because that'll be the one that the other stuff is just means nothing compared to the book of life, amen? Most important book. But to give you a kind of a background on the feast, if you put that slide up actually that shows the different feast there, there you go. So this is very, 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 very to infinity important. It looks like just a bunch of feasts on the board. Okay, why do we worry about something that was instituted thousands of years ago? And by the way, it's still going on today. So the feasts are still practiced today. So that tells us the importance of God said keep 3 points of feasts. But interestingly enough, the feast is an outline of the history of the Lord. Because it talks about the messianic job of Jesus and what he's going to do. So Passover, which is the spring feast, that's when Jesus was crucified. You guys remember that? So on Passover, he was beaten and then he was hung on the cross. But then they had to take him back down off the cross because the next feast was coming up was first fruit, so unleavened bread. And they were able to get him off the cross because unleavened bread was coming up. And remember, if he was crucified on Thursday, maybe a little time left, maybe we can debate or whatever. But I'm just saying Jesus comes out. He's crucified on Thursday at 6 p.m. that night, started the next feast. So it's Passover up until 6, but technically Passover started on Wednesday. That's when he had the supper with the Last Supper. And what happened is he went to Garden of Gethsemane and he saw where it was night time. It's about like the third watch or something like that. It's like 9 o'clock at night. And so he went and he was taken to jail, they put him in prison that night, and then they brought him out in the morning before Pilate, and then they said, just crucify him. That was on, let's say, Thursday on Passover. But then at 6 p.m., because Jewish time is a little different than American time, the next day started at 6. So they went to him another bread and said, I had to take him off, I had to take all these men off the cross because they kept hanging for the feast of unleavened bread. So they here's Jesus, but he's already dead. Now, I thought he was buying bread to fulfill so many prophecies. Then, so because he was unleavened bread, Jesus was the sin of sacrifice. So, a little bit of yeast destroys the whole battle, because Jesus had no yeast, he had no sin in him. He was perfect. He was the perfect lamb. So, the Passover lamb was a lamb that was personal to you. I'm just giving you a background. It was personal, you had taken into your house. You had to like befriend the lamb. You're like, oh, I'm looking at the lamb, you're going to kill it. You had to keep it in your house. I don't remember how many days, maybe it was a week, but it was a while. You had to keep the lamb with you. You get to take care of it, fatten it up, and slaughter it. Because sin requires a penalty. Sin requires blood. It requires an atonement. It requires something that has to die. And that's why it's important when you sin that you don't keep on sinning, because that's why it says to sin is to re-crucify Christ all over again. Because when you keep doing it, something has to die. Something dies when you sin. That's why the blood of Jesus is the one who brought sacrifice to sin. And it caused that man no longer needs to slaughter an animal, but Jesus was the one who brought sacrifice. And we are glad for that. Amen? Amen. So he was the Passover lamb. He was perfect in every way. And then he was the first fruit of the resurrection. He resurrected 3 days later, and we say Sunday morning. He resurrected. He was the first fruit of the resurrection because remember the Sabbath was in between the holy days. So you had Passover, then you had first fruit, then after that you had the Sabbath the next day, or 6 p.m. on Friday, you start the Sabbath. Then at 6 p.m. at night was Sunday, and that was the first day of the week where Jesus was resurrected and became the first fruit of the resurrection. Now that's important because we need to understand that we have a resurrection. There is hope. of blessed hope is that there is eternity. There is life after what you see here. What you're going through here is not going to compare at all to a pale comparison to what God has in store for you, what heaven has in plan for you, the welcoming committee that comes out to meet you in heaven when you pass or when you get raptured out. And I'll talk about that in just a moment. Is that this is a pale comparison here. But it's hard to get our mind wrapped around eternity when all we can think about is where we're at today. And that's why the timing of God is a little bit different than our timing. I wish everything was like this. I wish you could decree. It says, decree a thing, it shall be established. You know what it doesn't say? Decree a thing, it shall be established immediately. God doesn't say that. There's a little omission there. The problem is that we decree a thing, we establish it, because we don't see it, we think it's not happening. But everything you speak is happening. Good or bad, everything you speak out of your mouth, and you talk a little bit about it, where I want to go today, is happening, is doing something. If you send it out for good, it's going to do something good. If you send it out for evil, it's going to do something evil. So now we move on. 50 days later is the Pentecost. 10:5, 50 days after the first fruit comes Pentecost. And the Pentecost was obviously when the Holy Spirit was poured out of the disciples. And so you can do first by that to get back. So then, would you guys agree that Jesus fulfilled and the Holy Spirit fulfilled this thing? Absolutely, right? And it's the same thing. You can't even make that up. It's like the odds of all that happening that way are astronomical. It has to be true. There's no right way for it. So now, it brings us to a fall feast. These things have not been fulfilled. The trumpet, Rosh Hashanah, would equal the rapture, because that's the last trump. Jesus said those who are dead in Christ will rise, and those who are alive will remain caught up after them. Now, I can give you 1,000 reasons why this makes sense, but let's go back to the message that I'm talking today to review all that. But I talked last year in September on the rapture, and it's very clear through Scripture. Now, when does that happen? I don't know. I can't tell you that. But I can tell you that it's not for God's children to be in the judgment. The judgment is for the world, it's for the wicked, and for the ungodly. It's not for us. And so, literally, if you read the Bible cover to cover, you see the theme of God always protects his children. Noah protected him. They said, hey, he was righteous. I just read Ezekiel. And in Ezekiel chapter 14, you might write that down, but this stuff is really cool. He said, even if Noah, Job, and Abraham were here, they would be saved by the word of righteousness. But the word is prepared. When you have the righteousness of Christ, you will be saved. Because judgment is not for the believer. Amen? So that was quite a link. Okay, we just read it. We can read it. We just go. But I always need to read the Bible and look up some of the stuff to kind of see how that is. But anytime the Day of Atonement, now this is 10 days after the Feast of Trumpets. Remember, they had to look for the crescent moon, they had to blow the trumpet, it could be fog, it could be clouds, they could not see physically the moon before the feast begins. That's why you know when it's noon, but you won't know exactly the day or hour, because they had to wait until they can see the moon. So, Day of Atonement, 10 days, is the judgment of the world. So, when you see things, how it's kind of going to lay out, I'm just going to give you a brief overview. I'm going to study the background, because I'm not really going to go with it. I just want to give you some Hebrew history, because we're going to be talking about that. It's that the Day of Atonement has always been called the Days of Awe. Always been about you need to get right with the Lord. That's what the Day of Atonement means. Atonement means get right. It means that you come to your sin. And so the Day of Atonement is judgment against the world. It's about the Lord. And how many know that? If the church gets raptured out, that in about 10 days, the world's going to be freaking out, but then the seal starts to open. Then the time clock starts to work. The thing gets wrapped up really quick. It takes 7 years to your pre-tribulation. If you don't, it could be mid-tribulation, 3.5 years, whatever. Like I said, that doesn't matter. There's no reason to argue about what this point. But the point is, we're so close. Every year when the Feast of Trumpets comes around, like the first of the year, he says, he's going to do what he said he would do. He's going to fulfill what he's going to fulfill. He's got a job to do, and it's not over yet. The Messianic kingdom has not been played yet. that back. Ask me, where'd you go? Put that back. So when this happens, then it starts the process of tribulation. You see the tabernacles, and if you remember the desert, that big where the tabernacle is produced, and then that's with the celebrations, but really it's the manual in Christ, if you want to kind of see it. And that's how God works. There is such a type of shadow that everything that happens. Everything's a type of shadow of Jesus. That's how it is. It's hard to understand, but it says to the, if the glory of God is a clear matter, if the glory of King is defined out, and your King's been preached, amen? So we need to search these matters out. He doesn't want us to be in darkness. He doesn't want us to be in despair. He doesn't want us to be unhopeful. He wants us, the Titus says it's the blessed hope. The blessed hope. Now, is it escapism? No, because you have to go through some things because I believe that Jesus comes back and church by his blood. The church is not that. Look around. The church is not what it used to be. It's not in its heyday. If people are no longer coming to church, they're barely watching a live stream, they're not really into what God wants to do because everyone's got their own thing going on. It's a busy world. You know, we add in the sports and things coming out these days. It's like, there's something to do every night of the week. It makes you tired, it makes you weird, it makes you break. I'm not saying it's a bad thing. I'm saying that you got to make time for God. You got to make time for reading the Bible. You got to make time for praying because this thing is about to wrap up and you don't want to be caught off guard on it. It's the most time to be awake and alert and focused on what's going to happen. I've got good news for you today as you're about to step into an open door. The door already opened and now we're going into a new season. I want to talk about that. So we're going into season 7. Remember what day this is? October 2nd. They got it down now, and it is not exactly the same. It's not like the other days are exactly the same, but those still will work on this just at the right time. So, that's going to run down like that. So, the next slide there, like I said, I'm trying to talk to you guys here. I hope you're okay with this. It's a little different message today, but I'm really excited because me personally, I need a change. I need to see some fruit. I need to see just something from God that's so much bigger than me, that it's like this God. Amen. Are you guys hungry for something like that? We have to, because faith is a hard thing. When you keep believing for something that doesn't happen, if the devil just chisels your faith down. There's something wrong with you. Yes, God can hear you. Yes, your faith doesn't work. Yes, you're going to be laden with this illness for the rest of your life. Yes, you're not going to be able to pay your bills. Yes, you got this judgment against you. Whatever it is, Satan's job is to whittle away your faith, to cause you to partner with his world and not with God's world. Amen. You got to be careful what you agree with. You got to be careful what you partner with. You got to be careful what you watch, what you listen, and what you speak, because these things will affect your destiny. Because you can change it. And so we're going to run into a new season. This excites me, and I'm not a Hebrew expert, so do your own research. I just want to bring you some little mountaintop details that you can kind of focus on. But this right here, this is a Jalut, and this is for 5784. Now remember that we're in Jewish time calendar. Forget the Greco-Roman calendar. We're not in that time. We're in the Jewish calendar. The Jewish calendar is 5784. That's pretty close to 6,000, right? There's no time before that. We don't know when this time thing actually started. But this is a Jalut, and what this signifies in Hebrew is the number 4, and it's actually a word and a numerical value, a number. And it shows an open door. And the reason why is because there's nothing here. So the signification here is there's an open door that you can walk in. That God is opening a door for you in this year. But what's he opening a door to? What's the realm? We have to think of things bigger than the way we can see things. How big is God? He's got big plans in the kingdom. Amen. So now we come over here, and now the 5785, which is October 2nd, is the letter A, the number 5. So 5 is a letter and a number. But what this signifies is breath. It's breath. And that is how Hebrew is very descriptive. And how it works is that you're coming through an open door. Now, this door signifies the tent of meeting. Now, what would happen if the tent of meeting? You would meet with God face to face. That's the tent of meeting. And so, this door is opening the way to meet with God face to face. And then, as you walk through the kitchen, separated by his office, he's breathing his breath of life back into you again. He's breathing out of you, and he's breathing his Holy Spirit. And he's giving you the breath of life once again. And those things that you've been waiting for, that have been stuck over here, are breaking free over here because God's about to release his Holy Spirit. I urge you to step this out because there is more nature than I do in the desert. Don't really listen to what I'm saying, but you're not even getting close to the attempts to release. You can spend an hour or two on this. But it's amazing what God is doing. He speaks to us through his word, and Hebrew is his language. He used Greek in the New Testament, so we're not messing with Daniel himself. But Hebrew is the language God is teaching through today. And so there's a new season coming out. How many are ready for the new season? Six of us, eight of us, okay, all of us. Thank you. I'm telling you, man, this has been a lot of good season. We've seen that the wickedness has become more wicked. You know, there was a time where people didn't know evil outside the house. It was hidden. It was done in the background. It was done in the dark. It was done in the corner. It was always hidden. No longer, right? They're blocking it right out open. What changed? What changed? Now, for me, what I feel is that, actually, let's do Revelation 12, verse 10. Revelation 12, I'm skipping that for a minute. So, therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in the lowly inhabitants of the earth, and the sea, for the devil has come down to you having great wrath, because he knows his time is short. Don't do it, man. He knows his time is short. And so what's happening is, all of a sudden, that verse starts to make sense. Because in 2017, the rest of Revelation 12, you guys can read this letter, it's not part of the message today. But write it down, you want to read this. Because it said, and I saw a woman clothed with the sun, and said, the sun, moon, 11 stars on her head. And she was about to give birth to a baby. The dragon saw it, he's going to give birth. And he chased her into the desert. And she's like, that's weird. What are you talking about there? But it's celestial. God has a time clock in the universe. He uses, it's not astrology, it's astronomy, it's a different thing. We're not going to look at the sun. We're going to use God's contact. He lines things up for a reason. He's like a big clock, you know, it's 12 o'clock. And so that sign happened in 2017. It was like Jupiter was actually coming down from the woman. They called that being a plague, the woman was Libra, and they called this, she was having a baby. Virgo, I thought it was coming. And so she was having a baby, and Jupiter was coming out. That was the child. And so it was a depiction of a season and time. But what happened is, when the devil that happened, he just said, woe to you, heavens of the earth, because it's right in chapter 12. He's coming down to you, and he's furious. And look at those, it's around 2017, 2018, he just got crazy out there. It's been going on and on and on and on. I mean, to the point now that any award show, I don't know if you guys remember a season or anything, I don't watch the show, I watch like movies about the show, but it's just so demonic. It is about witchcraft, it's about devil worship, it's about sacrifice. I'm talking about real people sacrifice, not just giving up your time and your money. It's demonic as hell. And it's coming for the truth. It's coming against the people. And you know that if we actually produce this presentation, I'm just kind of talking to you today, and I'm going on things when I'm doing this stuff. But they produce, when they make a record of Alabama, I think it's still called Alabama, but when they do that, they become a witchcraft ritual of every song to make sure that when that person hears it, it releases a curse. Hear me now. It releases a curse. They pray a curse over that why do they pray a prayer for them? Because only human beings can authorize the demonic or the angelic to operate here on earth. Yes. Because you have the authority by what you speak to allow things in your life, both good and evil. And so what they do is they produce a curse, and the moment the person listens to the song, they agree terms and conditions. They agree with that song, and they agree as they listen to it to abide by the terms and conditions, which release a curse over their life. It's worse than you can imagine, deeper than you can even think of, because we think like, oh, that could never happen. It's like, you don't know how evil is. Evil has no boundaries, evil has no limits. The only limitation of evil is getting to heaven with Jesus Christ. That's the only limitation that keeps everything in check. But obviously, evil is being more evil, more vile, and it's being more out of the open for what can happen. Because Satan's not here to know, and he knows it's in the story. His goal, their goal, is to rule the kingdom. See, Jesus took back Satan off of him at the cross, before he went to the cross, in the desert, at the temptation. Satan said, I'll give you all the kingdoms of the world. He just bowed down and worshiped me. Who had authority over the kingdom? Satan. He had the authority. He couldn't offer anything to Jesus. He didn't have authority over it. It's a spiritual thing. He said, it is written. And so, Satan had the kings of the earth taken from Adam back in the garden. So for those years, those millennia, when Jesus went to the cross, it was the right time. He took back the keys of death and Hades. He took back the keys, that is where the hallelujah, amen. He took back the keys of the kingdom. When he took back the keys of the kingdom, Satan no longer has authority in this world only by that which people give him, because now he's been given power and dominion over the earth. God said, subdue it. Take dominion over the earth to Adam and Eve. He said, it is yours. I've given you everything here on earth for you. It is your dominion. Now we think, well, it's God's dominion. It's not God's dominion. It's good enough to lie your head right now. The earth is not God's. I mean, the fullness thereof it is, it overall is, but he gave us dominion over it. He wants us to take. It's kind of like, let me give you an example here. It's kind of like, I guess your dad gives you a car, and you can do whatever you want with the car of yours. You don't have to ask for the keys to drive it. You don't have to do anything crazy or silly. Maybe you have to put gas in it. But he's giving you the car. If you're able to use it anytime you want. Well, the kingdom of heaven is a terrible, terrible example. But God has given us dominion over the earth. We can use it the way we want it. We can advance the kingdom of heaven by partnering with what God says. Or we can do nothing and watch the kingdom darkness for death. And when you don't do anything, it's just as bad as aligning with darkness. You only have a choice. You really don't even have a choice. I mean, there's only like one option. You're like, what's the option B? No option B, because option A is you can execute your head forcefully and be a forceful man and woman and lay hold of it and advance it here and there. How do you do that? You go through prayer. You do that through reading the word. You do that through proclaiming the wonders of Jesus Christ. How good God is, and say these things out of your mouth, because the moment you start to decree something, oh, woe is me, I'm so bad, God hates me, I'm no good for nothing, the devil's like, you're right. I'll agree with that. And now you wonder why things don't get better. Because the devil's like, he's just wearing you down again. He's going to wear you down until you decree the word. Until you decree the things of faith. Thomas comes up out of me. It's important because as we go into the season, put that back up. Well, here, let's do this right here. As we go into the season, from 5784 to 5785, God is shifting things. You're going to see a breakthrough. You're going to see things that will happen. I need this so bad because I'm so tired of the way things are being, the way things go. I'm like, Lord, I my wife's like, now what are we doing? I'm like, it's the baby. We're being obedient is what we're doing, but it's not easy. It's not easy just working the ground and being like, man, Lord, When do we see the breaker? When do we see, you know, lay hands on the sick and we will recover? When do we see the demons speak with prayer? When do we see the presence of God so powerful that you don't want to do anything but stay on the floor and worship the King of Kings and be overwhelmed by the presence of God? When do we get to see that in church? When do we get to feel the God's presence and know that, you know what, everything I thought who I was, everything I had doubts of is wrong? Because one day in the presence of the Holy Spirit of God is worth a thousand elsewhere. How many want that? We gotta have that. There's gotta be a chance. Church, as we know it, can't keep existing with the presence of evil in the world today, because the evil produces more counterfeit signs and wonders than the church does real signs and wonders. It's an epidemic. But I believe it. We're going into a season to shift everything. And I believe it's about something. I believe it in every fiber of my being. I want to tell you this, but I don't believe it. I want to tell you, I'm telling you that go a little farther and don't give up now because you're almost there. There's going to be things that are frightful. There's going to be things that are not really pretty out there. There's going to be things happening in the economy. There's going to be things happening. The presidential election is gold. I don't even have people think about that. I can just tell you right now by experience, there's going to be some stuff going on in the presidential election with Kamala, who's the most craziest lady on earth, against Trump, which, you know, probably like the craziest guy on earth, by the way. If there was ever a battle between good and evil, we're seeing it at the presidential election. We're seeing the most liberal, leftist, out there person running for president that wants to kill your babies, wants to tax your house if it increases in value. I'm like, oh my gosh. And then you go to sell it 10 years later and it's way down. Like, I'll just take it right off on the taxes. But it's so bad, the ideas are so bad. But anyway, I'm not getting political. I'm getting spiritual. I'm telling you that what you're seeing manifesting political is a sign of what's manifesting in the spiritual. It's what's happening in the supernatural. What you see in the natural is because of the supernatural. If you want to see a change in the natural, you have to go into the Holy of Holies. You have to go into the supernatural to affect the change so it comes down into the natural. In Romans 4, it says, call those things in as though they are. The problem is shall be. We have the power and authority to speak these things, yet we go around and we say things negatively or badly that don't align with the Word of God. And so we wonder why things keep happening. But I'm telling you, when we get our minds right, our hearts right, and we get into the Word, and this is why we're starting prayer tomorrow night, because it's going to be about prayer. It's going to be about fasting. This is not going to be an easy one and done on the fly prayer. Oh God, let your will be done. I'm here, making sins in heaven. Amen. He's like, man, you got to dig in on this one. Because the evil is in the world. They're witches, they're warlocks, they're wicked people. They are assembled. They are placed in person. We have to sacrifice here on the lot. A while back, but I'm just telling you that they are busy coming against the churches. And if you don't think that hex, death, spell, witchcraft, incantation is effective against God's people, you're probably mistaken, because it can be if you're not constantly covered by the blood and wearing the armor of Christ. If there's a crack in your armor, then some of the stuff can get through. And we're like, you gotta be so holy right now, so geared up, so mounted with the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the shoes of the gospel of peace, the belt of truth, the shield of faith, and then you've got to take that offensive weapon, the sword of the Spirit, and you've got to start swinging out like you did this planet before. Jason used a jawbone to kill 1,000 people. What happens if you use the Word of God? What can you do in the demonic realm? You can slaughter demons. You know? It's time to like, get about the Lord's business, because we can't complain about it anymore. We went this far and no farther. Now it's time to enter through the gate. It's time to enter through the door. In fact, Jesus, John 10:9, he said, I am the door. If anyone enters by me, he will be saved. See, he is the door to the kingdom of heaven. He is the door. Everything makes sense when you go back to the original. He's the access into heaven. You go by the door. You enter the door through Jesus Christ, and you will be saved. You go into the door. And he says, now if you've been in the door, let me take you a little bit farther in, 57:85. Let me take you in to my breath. Wow. You want to be in the Spirit. how God gives us grace. Grace that we've handled is supernatural. Doesn't mean about the word for the Greek. It doesn't mean like God is sin. Grace is superpowers and it's supernatural. We've got it all wrong. We've got these things like, well, grace covers over a much bigger thing. No, grace is. You didn't say good. Just leave it there. Yeah, you just leave that up for a moment. Grace is a gift of the Holy Spirit to enable you to do supernatural wonders. To say to this mountain, go from here, be cast into the sea. To say to this valley, be raised up and made of rubble in the name of Jesus. Grace gives you the ability to do that. As we move into this new season, I talked about a lot of your gifts. Because you need it for the kingdom of heaven. But you need it. You need to be able to stand strong and mighty and know that God is God. That when He says something, He will do it. Now, it may not be in the timeline we want, because He's made me promises from 25 years ago. I still haven't yet to see and say, son, just a little bit longer. I thought to reveal that to you. I'd like to release that to you. There has to be a season, there has to be a perfect time frame for Him to do these things. And He created you for a purpose, and the time is now. If you want to talk about Esther, you know, He knows you were created for a time such as this. You're here today, you're brought here today for such a time as this. It's not by accident, it's not by mistake, it's not by chance. You guys came up across the street and said, you know what, I've been in this place for 5 years, it's been here when we try it once. It's not by mistake. Because this word has to go out. It cannot be turned forward. It has to create a change in you. But you have to partner with the change. And you have to agree with the word of God, saying, I'm going to do this. Lord, I want to be coming to your spirit. I'm going to be. I want to be in your presence. Because something that costs you nothing means nothing. If you put something into it, you'll get something out of it. Coming into church with no expectation, you'll probably be with no expectation. No fulfillment. But you put an expectation on what God's going to do. You start to believe that He's able to do what He said He would do. And you start to partner with that. And all of a sudden, everything changes. But it takes two times. He's been preparing His bride to come into an open door where He breathes His breath on us and we have a perfect lockstep with the Holy Spirit. How cool is that to be a perfect lockstep with the Holy Spirit? 5780 is called Peter. It is the decade of the mouth, the word of expression. So 5780 is here and started. It's 2020. It's kind of interesting. It's like 2020, man, ain't nobody loving 2020. I'm the Lord of the world changed on 2020. And so, it is the decade of the mouth to speaking out of things. And so, I think it's interesting that as we speak these things out, that we are causing things to happen in the supernatural realm. And that's how powerful your words are. We'll be talking about that quite a bit. I feel like 6785 is going to be the year that we actually start to see this thing happen with this next month. So we want to celebrate that with you guys coming in on October 2nd. And October 6th, after 3rd, we'll have dinner here. Just to celebrate. I think it's cool. I mean, you guys like having dinner? It's not fun, right? It's not fun, right? It's not fun. It's fun. Pretty thankful. Our second point today is that there's a season of preparation. We talked about Joseph and how Joseph prepared. He knew things were coming down the pipe. He knew the seasons were going to change. That what was all wonderful, what was all glorious, all of a sudden was going to change like that. He knew it and he prepared for it. In the same way, things are going to start to change. I'm not doom and gloom in it. I'm just saying it's good for you to be prepared. It's good for you to have to be able to come up with a food and water. You don't have to be rice and beans, but you know what? Hey, if you're hungry, rice and beans are delicious. But I encourage everyone to have a little bit of food and water on hand. There is so much tourism going on. We want to take the power grids at. And our power grids are so susceptible to attack right now. It's not really that hard for them. Do you guys remember that CrowdStrike game thing when they were, what, 3 weeks ago? When airplanes could fly more and shut down each other and shut down this kind of thing? You know, that's just a small thing that could happen. That's just like a little taste of what could possibly happen. But there are a lot of things happening with the economy. You know, the dollar, it has a crash. There's no reason in the world for it to go right now. Still, the good things in the world. As long as the world keeps loving that dollar, but they don't love the dollar, when the treasury prints them by the hundreds of billions of dollars every week. They're like, I don't like the dollar anymore. That's not just like, hey, we're going to print our own again. We're going to do like $100 billion a week, too. And it's not going into inflation and recession at the same time. They're going to keep resting. And so, we're seeing things change. That's it. It's not a scary time because I believe that the wealth of the rich is being transferred to the righteous. How does that happen? I don't know. But I know that you can't fear and you have to trust God in this situation and this time. And obviously, pray for the presidential election. Pray that God uses the death to protect or die. Because those things exist there. And there, you know, there's tough choices. Now we got a monkey pants. You know, we got a monkey pants. We got a monkey pants going around. Crazy. But it's a real deal. The meanest global agenda is to depopulate Earth to 500 million people. The reason why there's such a move towards AI, such a move towards the robotic, is they want to replace humans because humans are needing to use resources. And according to their gospel, there's not enough resources on the planet for 8 billion people, but the 500 million is just right. And they need to choose who that 500 million is. So it's become a spiritual battle. Operate in a spiritual realm requires us to go higher, farther, and deeper than we've ever gone before. I can't take you out of your comfort zone. You're not going to like going supernatural. But once you get there, it's like working out. First you work out, and you're like, wait a minute, oh, I just work out. This is for the birds. This time I feel weaker, I'm in bad shape. But then I feel like a week or two, you're like, I'm going to go to bed. Same thing with like the terrible energy, but it's the same thing with the spirit. You have to work out the spirit. It doesn't feel comfortable at first. It's hard. It's like, I don't know, I'm just not doing anything. But you can't go by your feelings. You got to go by what you know. And you know the Word of God. The Word will never change anything. It'll accomplish that what it's been supposed to do. And when you speak God's Word, I'm like, what if the powerful is that which is the ultimate God's Word here on earth and command it to become what it is that you set out to do? So we don't live by what we see, even though we live by what we see dictate how we live. Let's be honest. We look at everything around and say, this is the way it's going to be, this is the way it's always been, this is the way it's always going to be. That's not the way it has to be. And I'm encouraging you that going into this new season, that you can shift everything because God's grace is on you to move everything from lots of days ago to place it, from pardon, into something supernatural. And it's only going to be that after us, we want to go the supernatural way. Because it's going to cost us something. But it'll be returned. An investment is costing you something up front, but expecting a greater return in the future. And that's how it is with the supernatural. It costs you up front, it's going to cost you time, it's going to cost you energy, it's going to cost you finances, I don't know. But the return is so much better. So much greater than what it was going to cost in the first place. So, ladies and gentlemen, the King James phenomenal of King of Heaven. Can you go ahead and close from worship? I'm telling you today, this is just a warning of preparation that is trying to be about the Father's business. And we need to put our petty purposes aside. We need to put those things that don't mean anything. I'm going to go to the hospital. Let's hit the lights here. I think we're on that light. And I just stand up. I said, I just want to tell you what's on my heart today. But I'm telling you this because I couldn't bear to not tell you the truth of what's going to happen. And you just be like, why do you even want us? Most of you already know. It just did not come as a surprise. It's not a shock. If you're in the Word of God, you kind of see this. But I want to say this, if the Spirit is coming, you're going to see a literal move where God's going to move on your behalf on everything you do. If you want to be in a position where you can see that. Thank you.